Hi, I'm Harry Lipson, and I'm almost no longer the president of the James A. McKee Association. I've got like a little time to go. This is my last official function, and I can't tell you who's going to be the next president, but I hope it'll be somebody interesting. We had a schedule all worked out for tonight, but there are two changes that we need to announce. And the first one is that our mayor is not well. He's well enough. He's well enough for a politician, I mean. And so he has to be put on first, and we, of course, agreed to that. And the second thing is that later in the program, we've had some discussion amongst ourselves, and I've talked to Patty Bates and to Brian Hausch about this. There are some questions about the flyer that we all got in the mail, about the changes that the commission is suggesting that we vote on for changes in the village charter. And so Sheila Miller and Brian Hausch are here to talk about that a little bit late, actually last on the program. And by that time, we'll walk around with microphones in case there are any questions, because there's just not going to be time to get questions up here. Now, as I said, I'm not in charge. The lady sitting behind me, Jalen Rowe, is in charge. And I have to tell you, she's a fearsome lady. So when she speaks, we all listen. And if you don't do exactly what she says, she gets a little bit disturbed. So that's why we put her in charge, because we're all from Yellow Springs, and we need somebody like that. All right, so the rest of the program, I'm going to sit down and get out of everybody's hair. The rest of the program, she's in charge. Thank you.
Thank you, Jerry. I have responsibility with no authority. So just a few housekeeping notes. I do want to welcome everybody to the James A. McKee Association Candidates Night. I think this is such a wonderful service that this organization puts on. And as Harry said, he's not going to be president any longer, but the doors are open for anyone who wants to lend their expertise and join this organization for the things that they do here in our village. We do have a little change, but before we get to that, I don't want to keep the mayor up too long. I just want everybody, if you could turn off your cell phones or at least put them on vibrate. And if you do have to take a call, please exit and do that. The restrooms are out this door down to your right. We will have questions being asked by, you can write a card. Your question on a card, and it will be collected, and we will ask that question. We do ask that all cards be signed, so there will be some legitimacy to them. We might edit the questions. We're trying not to do any personal type of, I don't know the word, but let me just say, I'll let him say.
Attacks on person.
So we might edit the questions a little bit, but hopefully to get the answers out. We do have a wonderful timekeeper, Mr. Bob Harris. Each candidate will have 5 minutes to introduce themselves. Then when 30 seconds comes, he'll show that sign. And if you continue to talk after the 30 seconds, he'll show his cane with the hook on it. And he'll come get you. So please be respectful of his of the timekeeper. Thank you. I do ask that you have patience with each other, with the candidates, with me, as we go through this. I want to take a little informal survey before we get started. How many of you have attended multiple candidate nights? Wow. That's awesome. Is there a mic there on the floor?
Yeah.
Can we bring the mic over to Becky? And Becky, can you tell us why you think it's important that, number one, that this is hosted and that people attend?
You got to give her a time limit.
No, I've just always done that. I just think you're better informed by attending these and finding out what our candidates think and what they plan to have for us. And I read it too. Thank you.
Excellent. Is anybody here for the very first time? Wonderful. What is your name?
Elaine Saluski.
Elaine Saluski. Elaine, why are you here? What did you want to get out of this?
Because we moved recently to Yellow Springs and I want to find out who's a good candidate.
She said because she moved recently and she wants to find out who's a good candidate. I think it's very...
How long have you been on the faculty?
I worked here for 26 years, but I lived at Clark High.
Well, thank you for being here now. And I think what she said is so important, that even if you're new to the village, or if you have interests or children, or you're taking a part of, this is the place to be. And I hope that in the future that we get others to come out for the very first time. So without further ado, I am going to turn it over to the incumbent is the mayor, is the uncontested candidate again. The mayor is recognized as the official head of the village for ceremonial purposes and proclamations, and I thank you for the one you did for my mother, and presides over mayor's court. And we have some questions regarding village law versus state law and some other things in regards to the mayor's court. So if you would just please introduce yourself with your background and then possibly get into some of those questions.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank the James A. McKee group here in town for hosting this, and to our moderator and our time man over there. I've been mayor now for 24 years and would like to make it at least 25. So if you vote for me, I'll vote for myself. So I'm assured of one vote, but no, I am honored to serve you as the mayor of Yellow Springs. I've been to classes over the 24 years for DUIs and for general citations and crimes, all in the misdemeanors. The only cases that the mayor hears are misdemeanor cases. So if it's a felony, it goes to Xenia. Let me then get to some of the question. Please tell us what percent of court cases that arise in Yellow Springs are eligible for mayor's court. Well, if there are misdemeanors, all of the cases, with the exception of those under 18, which go to juvenile court in Xenia, or cases that involve marital disputes, and I think it's the way it's written, it's a husband and wife, those cases cannot be heard in mayor's court. The other case that cannot be heard in mayor's court is a second time DUI within 6 years. And there are good reasons for that. Apparently, there were some mayors upstate who decided that the good old boy worked well and the problems, and they get their friends off. So the legislature eliminated that possibility. mayor's courts only deal with first-time DUI offenders, or if it's a second time, it has to be over 6 years. So they figure after 6 years, it's a brand new case again. So those are the issues or the criteria by which people come to court. What I would like to do is to I would love to have all cases that can be adjudicated under the village ordinances come to mayor's court first. Now, I would love to ask the council candidates if they would support that and mayor's court. What has happened in the last few years has been that a former police chief and his higher administrative officers put the squeeze on other officers to have all cases sent down to Xenia, which is wrong. You know, there are several reasons why it's wrong, one of which is if we have a community court, a mayor's court, why don't we use it? And we need to. The other reason is a simple revenue. If it goes down to Xenia, they collect a substantial amount of money for fines and for court costs. And it stays down there. It doesn't come back here, especially the court costs. So it's a limited amount of money that comes into the village. Now let me give you an idea of what's gone on. The officers have absolute discretion over who to cite in the mayor's court or go down to Xenia. I'm asking you to, maybe if we have to set a policy to have them go. Is that 10 seconds?
30,
no, it's 30.
10,
I'd say,
10 yeah. 9, 8,
7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Thank you.
Let you get back to your sick bed. Is there anyone that has a comment or a question for the mayor? Harry?
I'd like to comment on some things that I've learned in the last couple of days that follow from what you said. I now understand that all cases of juveniles must go to Xenia.
Yes.
And there's some sentiment in that regard because seeing as that's the case, a young person that makes a mistake has it permanently on their record, whereas mayor's court is not a court of record. And therefore, people in the village, young people in the village, especially under the age of 18 or even over, that make a mistake that they could learn from, if they go through mayor's court, it's not permanently on their record.
Yeah, I think there is something to be said for a juvenile court. One of which is that they're not really, they're not extremely punitive. They deal with the issues of the young person that's there. If they see that that young person could be rehabilitated or, you know, this was just one of those wild and crazy nighttime pranks that people don't like somebody bashing mailboxes. I had one of my boys in on one of those episodes, and I took him to task and let him suffer. And he went down to court, and he got his comeuppance, and that was good. Let's see, was there anything else on that? Okay.
Okay. Are there any other questions for the mayor before he goes back to the sick bed?
Get well.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you all. It was a pleasure. And I said, two more years. One of the nice things that I have is that I can do proclamations. had talked at various functions, one of which was your mama at her funeral service, and it was a delight. It was a delight for me to be present and be asked, are you going to walk me this way?
If we could have all of the Miami Township Board of Trustees please enter the stage. Either side, or we have stairs in the front now. The Miami Township Board of Trustees has two seats available, one for the full four-year term and the other a two-year unexpired term. We have five candidates that are actually running for those seats, volunteering their time, and we do appreciate it. In their opening, the candidates have been asked to please address three questions. One, how you feel about building a new firehouse and how it will be paid for. Two, what do you think about requiring specific township trustee seats to be filled by residents who live in the township outside the village? And three, what can the township trustees do to help retain the rural character of the township? Okay, let's start with, if you could introduce yourself and then work your 5 minutes, and we'll start with Dale.
That's a bad thing to have your name thrown in.
And pass that by the office.
I'm Dale Amstutz. I live out on West Hyde Road. I have a 160-acre farm there, so I'm small compared to Lamar over here. I graduated from Fairborn Baker High School, went to Southern State College, got an associate in farm management, went to Wilmington College, got a degree in agriculture and a minor in economics, and my minor said I wasn't making enough money. So after working for Landmark, the Green Elevator in Xenia, then for Tom Pitstick over in the Fairborn area, I got employment at the U.S. Postal Service, started in Bellbrook, and then in moved to Fairborn, now been there for 27 years. That pay was a little bit more stable. Real quickly on the questions here, because I know the time disappears quickly. How do I feel about the new firehouse and how will it be paid? 2 years ago, that was the same question I was kind of asking, is how are we going to pay for it? I think it's a good idea. I think we need a new fire station. It needs to be planned on. One of my thoughts is, if you don't set a goal, you're never going to get there, and you're not going to know if you got there if you don't have something to get there for. But I feel it's kind of a four-step plan. Have to acquire the property that's I think they've desired. Second is, of course, planning the project and trying to complete it. Another one is, and I didn't really put notes here in front of me, but I, same thing, I think I've done paper. But of course the final one is after the project is completed, the possible sale of the current property, which could help possibly recover some of the costs. The second thing is requiring specific township seats to be for somebody outside of the villages, because that includes Clifton. That is one of the reasons I ran 2 years ago, and I'm running again this time. We all live in Miami Township, but those of us that live outside of the villages, I feel we don't have the representation, and I'm not picking on anybody. I think everybody that we've had, including Mark, have been very good trustees. I have nothing negative to say about any more of my candidates. I know them also. I know on a little bit of a personal basis, and I have nothing I can say negative about any of them. But that has been always been one of my thoughts, is that we need representation outside of the villages. I believe Xenia Township, I believe that is one of the requirements to be on the Xenia Township trustees, if I'm not mistaken. Susan Spradlin, a friend of mine who's a trustee, I believe that she told me that. The third item that was talked about, how do the trustees help retain the rural character of the township? That is a tough one. I've been on the Miami Township Zoning Commission for at least 15 years. Coming up with a comprehensive plan several years ago was not an easy project. It took years to come to where we felt everything came in place and what we wrote would be good for 20 years. You have to plan ahead. You can't just react to things that happen with development. I live out there in the country for a reason. I like it there. I like to grow crops. I like to have animals. But even where I'm at, within a few hundred yards in Xenia Township, guess what? There's more buildings going up, more houses. If the houses aren't yet, there's a barn going up now. But two properties have been sold. It is tough. The farm is kind of like a 401k for the farmers. And Tecumseh Land Trust has done a very good job, I believe, trying to preserve ground. But as property values, especially farm values, increase, to purchase these development rights is requiring more money. And I believe Tecumseh Land Trust has been trying to distribute the money as evenly as they can. If they have 100 applicants and they really consider 20, there's probably three or four that only get any monetary funds when they finally make their decisions on trying to purchase the development rights. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. Boy, right on time, awesome. We love candidates like you. Next up, we're going to have, let's see, who's next in the alphabet? We're gonna have Don speak. And on deck, after this group, we're going to have the school board group, so if you could be ready.
Well, thanks to the James A. McKee group and all of you who are here, and to anyone who runs for public office. And I think this year, Yellow Springs is well served. I don't think there's a candidate running for any of our offices that couldn't do it. The elephant in the room with the township is the fire rescue facility, fire department and administrative office. And this has been on the table for a few years. And from the outside, I'm feeling like we've been a little too cautious, but there may be things going on that I don't know about. I know that we have the cash. Why don't we buy the preferred land? Again, there may be a reason, and maybe we may hear about that tonight. Whatever steps are taken is going to be the biggest expenditure that the township has faced. And although I think that the fire department's well run, the roads are the township's responsible for are being paved. Cemeteries that the township's responsible for are being cared for. Doing a good job with rural zoning. It's kind of a local mystery. Maybe because the job is being well done, it's become a secret. We need to have up-to-date website. We need to have our township meetings on the web, maybe through YouTube or whatever. People who reside outside of Yellow Springs don't get Channel 5. When we come to ask for a tax levy to pay for a new firehouse, people are going to want to know what's been going on. So if I'm elected township trustee, I'll do the work of an up-to-date website, an annual printed report, and consistent regular communication to the voters. What's our second question? My understanding is that state law would have to be changed to make a formal requirement. But in my own view, it's important to have someone living outside of village limits of Clifton and Yellow Springs. And for that reason, when Lamar first ran, I printed his literature and circulated his literature. And I did it the second time. If we had a big dispute about zoning in the township, having an active farmer on the board is important. Okay, I thought I'd yell them out. And
what can the town
more generally, my whole life I've cared about the rural character of our area. Active in the Tecumseh Land Trust, you may recall I was briefly interim director of Glen Helen. But at this point, I think our hands are sort of tied. We've got a conservative zoning arrangement, so farmers can't contribute to sprawl in a dramatic way if they really want to cash in their 401k. But I think the biggest protection is the prosperity of farms. Farms make money at the moment. And I would welcome ideas for improving the prospects for agriculture, maybe the coming wave with buy local and niche agriculture may bring in more per acre, and maybe the Yellow Springs as a village can help with that. The main thing is whatever we can do to encourage farmers to keep making money.
Thank you, Don. Next up, we have Chris. Chris, please introduce yourself, and you have 5 minutes.
Thank you, Jen. Thanks to the McKee Association for holding the candidates tonight this evening. I was enjoying coming to them. I think these handout answers our questions have been answered pretty succinctly at this point. I'm going to go off script just a touch and get a little more personal. Contrary to what some people might think, the position of township trustee is not one where you sit at a big desk and put your feet up around Mark. It's really a job. Actually, many jobs. Okay, most of the time I might be crunching numbers, trying to get expenditures to match revenues, or dealing with personnel or equipment issues for the fire department or the road department. The jobs get a little bit weird. The 4 a.m. call where I've got to get up and go get into a snowplow and go out and plow some township roads in a blizzard. I guarantee that'll keep you awake. Or sometimes the sheriff will call and say there's a tree branch that's down over a township road, and I've got to get a chainsaw out and go out and cut it up and drag it off the side of the road. Lots of different jobs. I take metal detectors and go out and look for lock pins in the cemetery so we can mark out a grave that needs to be dug for a funeral the next day. These jobs require three things. They require experience, they require knowledge, and they require, probably most importantly, dedication to do it. I think I'm the candidate in this election that has those skills. You know, this township and this village have been very good to my family and me. You've supported my businesses over the years, literally put a roof over my head, our heads, and food on our table. Heck, here he lives it alone, probably paid my mortgage for a couple of years. I've always thought doing the best job I could as township trustee would, in a very small way, help to repay that kindness. And I hope to continue to grow. I'm very proud of the accomplishments that I've made during my time as a trustee. Just a couple. I'm the one who established the fund from the estate tax money for purchasing conservation easements in conjunction with the Tecumseh Land Trust for over 2,000 at this point. Unfortunately, that fund dried up. I'm proud of negotiating with Antioch University on the transfer of ownership of the Grinnell Mill from the university to the township. It's worked out very well. Just recently, I designed, and I oversaw the construction of the new addition to the Glen Forest Cemetery and to the Natural Burial Cemetery. And it's the Natural Burial Cemetery. It's only one of four in the state of Ohio that's certified natural burials. I'm very proud of that. With your support, I hope to continue on these projects. We've got multiple cemetery records that we're trying to digitize, so eventually we can get it so it can be searched over the internet for all the cemeteries in the township. Of course, we've got the site acquisition for the firehouse that's in progress, and eventually, as Dale well knows, the Zoning Commission is rewriting the zoning code to better reflect our long-range land use plan, and I hope to soon see what those recommendations are, and along with the other members of the board, make the decision whether to vote to adopt this plan. Again, I thank you for your support, and I ask for your vote on November 3rd. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Chris. He gives the rest of his time to the next speaker. That's going to be Lamar. If you guys have questions, go ahead and for this group, go ahead and write it on the cards, and I'll be happy to ask them for you. Lamar, please stand and introduce yourself, please.
Thank you. Thank you for the organization as this event and for inviting me tonight. I'm Lamar Spracklin. I've been a local farmer all my life, and my family's on both sides before me. I feel kind of bad. I have notes, nobody else did. That's my security here, so if I go totally blank, I can just read them. As I was considering what to say tonight, the word choice came to mind. We make choices, a lot of choices, every day. And a lot of times we don't give much thought to it. But when you really stop to think about it, the choices we make during our lifetime, as we go through life, determines our standard of living. Determines our well-being, our happiness, our health, and our longevity. Making choices is what the election process is all about. Is this loud enough sometimes?
Yeah.
In the trustee's office, we make important choices. We make choices. We meet the first week of each year. We appoint people to different jobs. Example of appointments in recent years has been the fire chief. His job is to recruit and train volunteers. So we don't have to have a hired, paid fire department. And another thing, appointment is the road superintendent. He's in charge of the cemeteries and the road crew. So these are examples of the appointments we've made in the last few years. Every year we also make an appointment. Zoning Commission person is appointed for 5 years. There are five people on the board. Who we put on the Zoning Commission is very important. It's more important than some people may realize, because they determine our zoning for the township. They make recommendations to the trustees. That zoning determines the rural character of the community. In the office, there are three trustees and one clerk. The current trustees and clerk have a total of over 60 years of experience and training. But that's okay. Fire department, you asked about the firehouse. At some point in the future, there may be a levy on the ballot. You don't know when that's going to be, whenever everything gets organized and can find the correct property. So the community will vote on whether we have a firehouse or not. It will not be up to the three trustees, it will be up to the community. I've been a trustee for 15 of the last 16 years. I came here tonight, ask for your vote for the two-year term that is available. Thank you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Lamar. And last but certainly not least, we have Zoe.
Thank you. I first just want to say what a privilege and an honor it is to have the opportunity to run for trustee and really to be a part of our democratic process in our country. A lot of people don't know this about me. I'm a very patriotic person. I love our country. I was born in Arlington, Virginia, and I was raised on the West Coast, the East Coast, and here in Yellow Springs. There's a lot of confusion about that. A lot of people think I'm a California girl, but I'm really a DC girl and an Ohio girl. I did make notes. I always love to add this little tidbit. Public speaking is the one thing that most people fear more than death itself. We can all relate to that, right? But it's really a lot of fun when you don't die. You think you're gonna die, but I always say it's just like getting a shot at the doctor's. The anticipation of it, that's the worst part. So I sat here hoping I'd go first, but it didn't work out that way. Anyway, I do have notes in case I forget how to talk, but I really want to speak earnestly and honestly and spontaneously about myself and how I would approach the position if I were elected trustee. So after graduating high school here in Yellow Springs, I went off to Oxford, Ohio, Miami University, and studied philosophy. As soon as I found out about the sister college, Evergreen State College, that was started at the same time by the same forefathers, I transferred immediately as soon as I could to Evergreen. I wanted to study art and psychology, and it was a tough decision to make because I wanted to stay in Yellow Springs, and here we had Antioch College, and that would have sufficed. My sister was at Antioch College, and I knew Evergreen would be a better fit for me. I did not want to leave Yellow Springs. I promised myself if I left and followed my dreams and pursued my education, I'd come back. And I gave myself a 10-year allowance, and it took me over 20 to get back, which is fine. I mean, life happens. And I had no idea I'd come back with a husband and three kids, and it was worth the wait. So it's been 6 years now, and I'm absolutely thrilled almost every moment of the 6 years that I've been back. I think I will continue to be feeling that way. So let's see, when I finished my bachelor's degree, I moved to Portland, Oregon, and did postgraduate studies there for a year before moving to San Francisco and getting my master's degree in art therapy and individual couples and family therapy. I really enjoyed graduate school. That was fulfilling my dream. I didn't necessarily want to become a therapist. Like I said earlier, I wanted to study art and psychology and philosophy. And becoming a therapist was just something I was gonna do to pay some of my student loans. But it was interesting. You know, life is full of surprises, and that's what's great about it. So I got into the field through creativity, through art, and quickly found my niche in the legal system. And I worked for many years as a county-designated mental health professional, which we don't have those here in Ohio. We have them in Washington State and one other state, that's Alaska. County designated mental health professionals are sort of the psychiatric police, and it's a very high skilled job where you're working with people that are a danger to self and others, doing crisis intervention, assessment and referral. It's exciting work. I was absolutely shocked to find out how much I loved it and how much I loved working in the courts, which was also not something I would have ever seen myself doing. I worked as a CDMHP, as they're called, in two counties. One of the counties was rural and the other was King County, which is where Seattle is. And my God, 5 minutes goes fast. So it was very different in the big city, of course, than in a rural community. Eventually, I supervised lawyers in family court and simultaneously taught graduate school at Antioch in Seattle and started my private practice, which I did that for about 10 years. That was the second business that I ran. The first business was a jewelry designing company that I started.
Thank you very much.
In Yellow Springs.
So thank you. I took 30 years to get back to Yellow Springs. The thing is, though, we all seem to come back. We do have one question from the audience, and on deck, I have Sean. The one question for the audience, Lamar actually did state it, was could someone clarify which trustee candidates are running for which seats? Lamar said he was running for the 2-year term. Is there anyone else running for the 2-year term?
No, I'm running for 4 years.
Okay. So 2-year terms, please hold your hands up. Okay. And so the others are running for 4-year, but just hold your hands up anyway, just so we can see it. 4-year term. And if you have any, if all of this didn't sink in, the Yellow Springs News has done an awesome job of interviewing via written word the candidates. So please take a moment, if you haven't gotten a chance thus far, to read the Yellow Springs News about the candidates and the questions that were posed to them. So let's see, the other question to all. How do you see the Center for Business and Education flourishing in the rural character of the township? Mm-hmm. Paul asked this question. Any thoughts? Microphone? How do you see the Center for Business and Education influencing the rural character of our township?
The CBE at the intersection of Yellow Springs Road and East Union Road is on the edge of Yellow Springs, but it's been annexed in the town, and I don't see it as a threat to the rural nature of the township. In my dreams, it could be a value-added agriculture product incubator or something like that on that spot, but I don't have the money to invest in that.
The only thing, being on the Zoning Commission, one of the things with any type of development or business around Yellow Springs is the way we look at most of that is it will should be in what we would call the Urban Service District, which this particular property you're talking about is, because that's where you have your sewer, your water, and your electric, and as many times here in Yellow Springs seem like they'd like, if people live in Yellow Springs or work at these places, where they could either bike or walk or someplace close. But most development, is, as far as the Zoning Commission is, would be in the Urban Service District.
Deal read my mind, thanks.
As I've said before, the key to zoning a rural atmosphere is the zoning people. Over the last, since I've been on board 15 years, I have tried to get people on the zoning commission that have long-time farmers, people that have had land for years and years, decades, and one of them even bought their farms back in the 1830s. These people have proven that they're not interested in development. They want to keep the family farms intact. Those are the people that I've tried to get on the and been successful at getting on the zoning commission. And I think they're the key to the rural atmosphere.
I'm personally a firm believer of the no sprawl concept. I don't feel that there should be no growth, but I feel like the growth needs to be very slow, very well thought out, looking at the ecological impact as well as the landscape. I want to say I've been to Hawaii, I've been to Alaska, I've been to San Juan Islands and San Francisco and Southern California, gorgeous places. I feel that Miami Township is just as beautiful, if not more so. I love this land, and I love the preservation of this land, so I just want to say that. Thank you.
We have a few more minutes. Are there any questions from the audience that they didn't get to write down? Okay, Lee, could I get a mic over here for Lee, please? Thank you, Jerry.
I have a question about the annexation of a part of Glen Helen, I think it's 425 acres, into the village. What kind of impact does that have on the township as far as, are there roads you won't be maintaining anymore? Is this a positive thing for the township in terms of handing over responsibilities to the village that the township had been responsible for? And I'll take answers from anybody who'd like to address that.
I think the Board of Trustees, actually just a few days ago, but the Board of Trustees probably considers this to be a net neutral transaction. There's really no infrastructure to speak of that the township ever maintained, and so we now would not be maintaining it. There's no income producing, there's no property tax producing. It appears as though if there's a benefit for anybody, it's a benefit for the Glen, where they would then get the police protection that they're looking for to help with their problems with vandalism and all other things that go on up in that area. So again, I think it's pretty much net neutral. I don't believe we're going to be losing anything. I don't like the idea, you know, of losing, you know, acreage, but it's, I think it's for a good cause.
Nick Budis was at the trustees meeting Monday night and explained this. It's for discipline and primarily so they can have some protection for their people. I don't have any problem with it.
I'd like to just add that the hot spots are already in the village. I'm in favor of this annexation. But the fear that this is going to dramatically, or maybe not dramatically, but be an added burden to police tasks and therefore village costs, I think is overwrought. The village already goes just about to the Cascades in the Glen, and the police already patrol.
I think you asked if this was a positive thing, if we thought that the annexation was a positive change, and I think it's very positive. I think it's absolutely all positive and no drawbacks that I can see. So I think it's going to help the safety of the Glen, the preservation of the Glen, and the people when they're out in the Glen. When there's an injury, if somebody falls or hurts themselves, That's obviously township and the rescue crew gets in there. But to have the police involved, if there's any kind of foul play, I think is going to be very good for folks.
Well, thank you, candidates. Can we get a hand, please, for the candidates for the Township Board of Trustees? And again, running for the two-year term, we have Dale and Lamar. And for the four-year term, it's Don, Chris, and Zoe. Thank you. The Yellow Springs Board of Education has two seats available for election, and we see one person sitting in the seat right now. We have Sean and Sylvia. Allison is not available. She too is ill at bedside, and Sean's going to speak on their behalf. The questions for the school board: one is about project-based learning, known as PBS. How do you measure PBS success? And are the students performing at grade level in the core subject areas? And the second question is open enrollment, regarding open enrollment. When is the outflow of Yellow Springs students? What is the outflow of Yellow Springs students versus open enrollment? And is there a system to determine the reason for outflows? Thank you, Sean.
Thank you very much.
Introduce your full name, please.
I am Sean Joseph Creighton. And thank you very much for this opportunity tonight and Events Group for hosting this. I am seeking a, I've completed 12 years of service, 2 4-year terms currently, and I'm seeking a third term for re-election up to the school board. Daytime, I'm the president of the Southwestern Ohio Council for Higher Education. It's a coordinating body for 22 colleges and universities in Southwest Ohio. I am also the father of 5 children. One who is we are proud parents of a proud graduate of the class of 2015 last year. I also have a kindergartner, a third grader, and a junior, and a preschooler who will be in Yellow Springs Schools in 2 years. I am speaking a little bit on behalf of Sylvia. Sylvia Ellison cannot be here tonight. She is seeking re-election for her second 4-year term. She sends her love, her regards, and as you probably already know, there are 2 openings and there are 2 people running. So therefore, Sylvia and I are running unopposed, and I have to admit, it makes the campaign trail a little less intense and definitely cheaper. We don't take this for granted that we're running unopposed. We think it is a bit of a sign that support is doing a good job, but we certainly do not take it for granted. Sylvia and I are both passionate about education, about public education, and about making sure that as a board, and we've got a great board right now. Am I talking too loud? Is that what it's coming out?
No, get it a little there. Try it right
here. Maybe I should slow down a little bit too. But I'm keeping an eye over here for my timer. We've got a great board, and we care deeply about the system and making sure that we are good stewards of the system. I want to get to the questions here. So project-based learning, how do you measure PBL success and are students performing at grade level in the core subject areas? The Yellow Springs Public Schools, we take every test that every other school district takes in the state of Ohio. And we based on the state assessment, since we've introduced PBL, we have done as good or better in all of the core subject areas. So that's one measurement around how we are doing since introducing project-based learning.
Sean, can we diverse just a little bit and maybe define project-based learning?
Sure. So project-based learning, from my perspective, and we certainly have, I would do a shout out to our superintendent, Mario Basora, who's in the audience. Hi, Mario. Project-based learning, from my perspective, it's experiential learning. It's really connecting sort of what content to its application. It's using a project to deliver the learning that you would normally get either through lecture or maybe through seminar. It's much more collaborative in its approach to teaching. It's more engaging, it's more fun. It challenges the students to deal with teams and come up with solutions to whatever the project is that the teacher is leading. So last year, 100% of our students graduated, 100%, and over 95% of them went on to college. Those are two clear indicators of success in terms of how students are doing in our schools. U.S. News and Report, you probably heard this, a World Report, ranked Yellow Springs High School as one of the best in the nation. We were first in Greene County, second in the Miami Valley, and 30th in Ohio. We have 881 high schools in Ohio. These accolades, they were based on reading and math and how we do with a diverse population. So they, again, they are clear measurements of sort of how we are doing as we introduce or transition to project-based learning. Last I want to say about PBL is that we did an internal survey with teachers to see how we were doing, and the all indicated that we're doing a great job implementing PBL, and as well their appreciation of it as a teaching method. The second question, what is the outflow of Yellow Springs students versus open enrollment, and is there a system to determine that reason? So we have about 780 students right now in the district. 175 of those students open enroll into Yellow Springs from other districts. And at the same time, about 100 of our in-district students do not attend Yellow Springs schools. Our current policy, just for your information, permits 33% of the total student population can be from open enrollment. Okay, waving. So we're about 22% right now. We publish a report each year on open enrollment, in and outflow. Most of the students who are outflow are homeschooled. We have about 13 students who actually enroll in other districts. And then we have several students who choose to go somewhere else for a variety of reasons. STEM education, or their interest in the arts or sports, or religious affiliation. So the board and the administration, we keep clear, we're very interested in the subject, and we want to deepen our understanding of the reasons so we can decide whether or not there's something we need to be doing. But I appreciate it. Thank you very much. I did go really fast. Yeah, I just wanted to say that the board and the administration, I mean, we definitely take a close look every time that report comes out to understanding what maybe we need to be doing as a district, or if there is anything. So we see the choices, the school choices that are being made by those who outflow, but we're trying to deepen our understanding of the reasons.
Do we have any questions from the audience? Yes, Craig.
Do your numbers also...
Wait, one moment, please.
Hi. Do your numbers also reflect a number of Yellow Springs students that participate with the Greene County Career Center? Is that incorporated in those numbers, or is that a separate category?
Great question. I think that's a separate category, because they're a partner with that school. So yeah, through our partnership, they don't count as... That's Alpha.
And one more over here in the corner, Jerry. Oh, you got one here? Okay. So?
Do you know if you guys are going to show that movie again?
What movie, so?
Yeah. The PBL movie that was at the Little Art. I think it was just played twice.
Right.
And it was excellent. But I'd like the whole family to see it.
Mario, I mean, I don't think it's something we have in the works to bring back again, but I guess once it's out on pay-per-view or on demand or something like that, it would certainly convey the fact that you can rent it.
It's pretty cool. $350 per showing, so that's pretty costly. We got a donor to give us two showings, but we don't know that that's a smart investment of our funds to get $350 more in this requirement for third showing.
Okay, we have one more question right over on the side of the room.
Sean, are the outflow numbers and open enrollment, et cetera, fairly consistent over the last 10 or 20 years? Have there been peaks and valleys? If that hasn't changed, then why worry about it?
Yeah, sure. The outflow definitely has been consistent. We have seen an increase of open enrollment, not necessarily year over year,
But this year, for instance, we probably could have taken more open enrollment students if we opened up another kindergarten class. But we were unable to do that really because of space limitations. And so that's, you know, that's something that the board and the administration look at carefully as we think about growth. We also, if I could add, we've seen a pretty significant increase in in-district kids as well in the past couple of years. So that's another positive sign of in-district, of families moving into the community and choosing to be here because of the Yellow Springs schools.
Thank you, Sean. Can we get an applause for our school board? And may I have Chrissy, Judith, Marianne, and Jerry please come to the stage. The Yellow Springs Village Council has three seats up for election. The two candidates with the highest votes will serve a four-year term, and the third highest will serve a two-year term. So I welcome to the stage our candidates, our four candidates for Village Council. And we have a few questions that were asked that we asked them to include in their opening statements. And the first question is in regards to fiscal viability in regards to new income sources and current operating fund deficit. And the second question that we'd like them to address is the infrastructure, storm sewers, roads, sidewalks, utility rates. And third is in the topic of policing, drug task force, community policing, and the department size. And we will start with, in alphabetical order, Chrissy. Please introduce your full name.
Okay, my name is Chrissy Cruz, and Yellow Springs has been my home since 1974, where I raised my two children and currently my grandson. I've worked at the Friends Care Center and at the Children's Center. And then I took courses in office technology and accounting, and I worked as an office manager and then a business coordinator and IT specialist for a subdivision of the Super Value Corporation. I've been on the Human Relations Commission for 2 years. And I've never missed a meeting and have volunteered for many projects and served as the treasurer. I have helped organize the policing forums and also the neighborhood block parties, which we had a record number of 16 parties this year, including one that I threw myself, which was to be a community-wide block party. I spearheaded the campaign to get a referendum on the ballot on the issue of the public funding of the CBE and whether you were for or against. I believe it was a gift to the community to allow every voice to be heard, and that the villagers got in. I was very proud that the villagers got involved and really explored the issue and came to a mindful decision on that project. Frequently during the referendum campaign, I heard that voting against the public funding was due to being anti-businesses in Yellow Springs, and absolutely nothing could be further than from the truth. I'm very supportive of local businesses, and I would actually be happy to see development on the CBE property. We need more business here, and we can do that by maintaining the infrastructure, rejuvenating the revolving loan fund, and keeping up with advances in technology. I'm strongly supportive of the businesses already established in the village, and I think that that's a big selling point for us if we keep our businesses that are already here healthy and happy and support them. Other businesses will see that and they'll want to come and set up in Yellow Springs. I feel that our infrastructure has many areas that need addressing, and council seems to work very hard on doing that. It's tricky, and finding ways to maintain it, I think, should be done by looking to the way things are done in other areas and tried and true ways of doing things. But I also think it's important to look for creative new solutions for how to do things. Yellow Springs, we take pride in being a unique community. We have a lot of creative minds here, and I think we can find new ways to do things. For the other issues,
I'm against maintaining presence on the AIDS Drug Task Force, and my reasons are not only moral and ethical ones, but also fiscal. The salary and benefits for a full-time officer, plus the yearly fee to participate, add up to nearly $100,000, and I don't believe it's a worthwhile investment for our community. I was interested that our mayor spoke about Mayor's Court, because I also strongly support localized policing, keeping as many nonviolent cases as possible here in our Mayor's Court. We have a Mayor's Court. Why not make full use of it and keep that revenue here as much as possible? And also, I feel that by the police officers having the discretion to decide where they choose to send cases, whether to Mayor's Court or to Xenia, I think that leaves a lot of areas open for discriminatory practices, and I think that that should be a set policy as soon as possible. Not being involved in the daily running of a police department, I find our chief to be pretty competent, and I leave that in his hands to determine how much staffing our police department needs. I've heard a lot of people say, well, for such a small town, we have a very big police department. Well, yeah, for such a small town, we do, but also a lot of small towns this size don't have such a big tourist trade and don't have so many events. We have events going on every weekend. We probably need more police officers than most towns this size. If I'm elected to council, I believe I will be an asset to the community as we look to the future. There are many things that will be new to me, but I'm a quick learner and confident in my ability to do the work necessary and willingness to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Chrissy. And boy, that was under time, too. Judith?
Hello, I'm Judith Hemfling. I'm going to stay seated because I'm kind of balancing some different notes here and my timer, because I have to keep track of that myself to make sure I'm not going to do that. Many of you know me already, but maybe some of you don't. I'm a hospice nurse, I'm a mother, I'm a grandmother. I've lived in town for about 19 years, and I was on the council for 8 of those years. Six of them I was president of the council. In the last 2 years, I took a little hiatus to rest and focus on home, on family, on what's going on in that larger world out there, which is pretty interesting. And I've come to the point now that I want to come back if people would like me to come back to the council and focus at the issues that I focused at before. Really, my values have not changed. I'm sure that's not surprising. So you can kind of expect the same focuses that I had the last time I was on council. Part of the work that I've done that I want to speak to, first of all, before I was even on the council, is the work that the whole community did, and I was a part of that, in saving Whitehall Farm from development. That was a big victory that's made a huge difference in this community. I fought for Antioch College and against its closure because it is economically, well, historically, culturally, the cornerstone of our community. And for that work, I got the Alumni Association's J.W. Dawson Award in 2013. I'm very proud of that. That was work I did with many people here, the alumni, the college community, and the fact that the college is coming back is a key issue for the health of our economy. And to the future, the village needs to partner as much as it can to support the success of the college. Clearly, the coming back of the college has been a huge positive for our community in the last few years. I'm going to be trying to answer the questions in the context of other things that I'm saying. I think in terms of the local economy, again, Antioch College, very important. Supporting local businesses, entrepreneurs, artists, and nonprofits should be our greatest focus in supporting the creation of meaningful jobs in the village. In terms of environmental sustainability, something that I had fought for when I was on the council was funding for the green space fund and farmland preservation. I think the village should continue to be providing some funding every year for green space and farmland preservation in the interest of our current and our future generations. And we should continue the work that the council did in terms of reducing the carbon footprint of the village. I'm very proud of the work the council did to the point where, as I understand, currently we are nearly 80% renewable in the portfolio of the electric system of the village. I support the efforts that citizens are doing now to try to do their part to reduce that carbon footprint, and I think we should continue to find ways to make that possible. In terms of affordability, the high housing costs in the village is the primary reason the village is an expensive place to live. And part of that is because of our high property taxes. So it's essential that we spend these monies wisely. Village government, I think, is intending to, and I agree that it needs to keep its spending within the current levy level. Encouraging housing and business development within current borders helps spread these costs over more people and prevents sprawl development. I also think the village should do its part to support affordable housing, and especially rental housing for low-income people. And I am for repealing the landlord utility policy, which was passed this last year, which I believe skirts that laws that protect low-income people's access to utilities. And I'm sorry, I haven't gotten to policing. We'll have to discuss that later. Because my time, I think, is up. Is it not? Oh, it's not. Oh, my timer's up. Okay. 36.
Our timer is the official.
Oh, okay, great. Okay.
I got 30 seconds.
Awesome. So I just want to say I support us leaving the direct task force. I believe it's part of a failed war on drugs. And I also think a public review of police policies would be important for us to be doing into the future. Some people in the village feel safer when police come their way, and some feel less safe. I think it's part of this national debate that we're having, and so it's important for
thank
us
you very much.
To do our part.
Thank you.
Well. Thanks.
Your time is up.
Thank you, timekeeper. We'll just let her finish her thought. I will say that we're asking the candidates to please, in all the elections, to please stay a little bit afterwards for individuals to come up and maybe ask questions on a more personal level. If you could do that, we'd appreciate it. Next up is Mary Ann.
I'm Mary Ann Queen. I am running for re-election on Village Council. I have my notes here and attempt to answer all of the issues, questions that were put before us. So I'll start with our basic services. The village does not make money on utilities, so whatever our utilities cost is what we have to put back to the customer, which is you. And as you probably can imagine, costs keep going up. So utility costs keep going up. That said, I think that the village does a good job of providing effective, efficient services at a reasonable rate. In terms of roads and sidewalks, I think that the program we have for maintaining our roads is working. The program we have for maintaining our sidewalks is less than perfect. I do think that our sidewalks are public transportation and that the village should be responsible for the sidewalks. Currently, the amount of funding that we have to repair and maintain the sidewalks is inadequate. I support putting a levy on the ballot to see if the community really wants to have the sidewalks be maintained in a much higher state than they are. In terms of storm sewers, storm sewers are the mechanism that we have to take the overflow of water. And our storm sewer system is less than complete. A downside of making it complete is that my understanding is it would be quite expensive, and my sense is but it would probably be more expensive than this community would be willing to pay. Also, a downside of storm sewers are that they take the water off the land, the impermeable surfaces, and with that they take the herbicides, pesticides, fossil fuels, and dump them into the Little Miami River. So what the Environmental Commission is doing is examining ways to recommend to council and for our citizens, for the residents and businesses, to look at how can we maintain the water on the land? How can we have the land be more permeable? What kind of systems can we use to keep water on the property to begin with? Let's see. And this is something that progressive cities around the country are doing, in part because it's cheaper than totally rebuilding storm sewer system. In terms of utilities, I support the village having its own solar array, and the Energy Board, of which I'm the liaison to, is working with staff to research this. I also support the research done on community broadband, and hope that this is something that we could have to offer as part of our services. In terms of increasing the village income and our village budget, the good news is that the budget for this, the end of 2015, we will have a deficit projected, but it's less than half of what was projected, and it'll be in the neighborhood of about $100,000. Assuming that we continue the current tax levy, renew it, for 2016 and beyond, we will be we'll be in the black. So that is great news, and I think we can thank both our finance officer as well as our village staff. And of course, part of the reason that we're doing better is because our income to the village is increasing, and that is a good thing. In terms of new income sources for the village, the only things that we can count on are either taxes or some kind of services or sales that the village can do. That's the only monies directly that can come into the village. Should we need to have increased taxes, and I'm not proposing that we do, I would definitely consider examining our reciprocal arrangement that we have for people who work outside of Yellow Springs and who frequently pay most of their income taxes to the areas where they work. 30 seconds. Okay. I think that we should get out of the drug task force. I believe the war on drugs has not accomplished anything positive in terms of lowering drug addiction and has created its own problems. I support community policing. I support housing initiatives, including the village examining a process to engage the community in developing housing, especially rental housing, on
Thank you very
the
much.
Glass farm.
And last we have Jerry.
First of all, I'd like to thank the James H. McKee Association for having us here tonight. This is my second appearance here. I was lucky the first time to get elected to council. Been on council now in my fourth year. Prior to that, I was 8 years on school board. Been in Yellow Springs just about 40 years now. Raised two children through our wonderful school system. And I am retired. Okay. Don't worry. And I think that's a key, because being on council is a 24-hour job. And I'm fortunate to say that I'm retired, so I can spend that time. I'm a working council member as a lawyer. I know. Don't have to do it, but I do it. When I first got on council, I understood that in order to really find out what goes on,
within the village, you gotta get out there and get your hands on it. And that's what I did. I worked with every department, fix water main breaks, mow grass, plowed snow, rode with all the police officers on all the many shifts to find out exactly what they did. And also to learn about the community. And you'd be surprised what you find when you go down the lower alleys and so forth we have in town. There were three questions that they have for each member, but I'm going in a different direction to answer those. I think the key to all three of those are to have competent people overseeing them. That means having a competent village manager, and I'm proud to say that the rest of my council members asked me to be the council liaison to find a village manager along with Brian. We have an excellent police chief, was not involved in that hiring, but we also have a very competent finance director. When I got on council, we had issues. This year, we're just about out of the red. Next year, we'll be in black. And again, I was fortunate to be the council rep in the hiring. In terms of income, I look to the people we have in place to, and they are the experts, not me, to help us determine just what sources of new income may be available to us. And then my job as a council person is to help pick the right one and present it to the community, have discussions, and then implement. Infrastructure. Roads, sidewalks. Roads are, you know, I think just about every street now has been paved. Sidewalks, we are not the first council that has been dealing with sidewalks. We will be dealing with sidewalks for years to come. The question is what type of plan we're going to come up with. And I feel it has to be a joint plan with council and the community and come up with a way that we both share the cost. In terms of policing, I have to say I am an advocate of the drug task force. I've been out to the task force. I've seen what they've done. They explained to me what they did. And from my standpoint, it is to protect small yellow springs. If I'm fortunate to be reelected, I would be very happy to serve the community.
Thank you, Jerry. Well, we have a few questions, actually several questions. If you could keep your answers short and succinct in answering the questions when they are given to the entire council candidates would be appreciated. We do have, after this, we will be having a little information given to us. So to no further ado, the first question to all village council candidates, each of you proclaim to be in favor of affordability within the village. However, please explain how this can be achieved without economic sustainability. We are not talking about home businesses to help offset taxes. We are talking about small to medium-sized businesses of 50 to 100 people to enhance our tax base and revenue base within the village. How are each of you going about to attract this type of white-collar business in order to maintain our affordability status? As it stands right now, we are no longer affordable with taxes and utilities on the rise. This question is from William, and whoever would like to respond to it first.
Economic development. It was unfortunate when our assistant village manager, who was, I was quite impressed with, left. But before he left, he put out an economic development plan. Now, I do have to say that I think that the village government has a limited role in what it actually can do for economic development. And I also think that most economic development happens within the village itself. Examples: Environment Flight, Yellow Springs Brewery, the Antioch Rebirth. We actually are experiencing, I think, and the hotel too. I think we are experiencing economic development, and certainly we are seeing it within the income coming into the village. I think what the village government can do is, one, sometimes it's getting out of the way. In other words, having zoning that allows businesses to be there. We are going to reinvigorate our economic development, sustainable economic development commission, and we are going to have one of the staff people, Denise Swinger, who will be a staff person to that commission. And the other thing, I guess, is that it's really the community itself that attracts businesses. And to the degree that the village government supports the community, having the kind of amenities that we have, having the kind of schools that we have, and having spaces for businesses to come, and people here who can work in businesses, I think that is the primary thing that's going to increase economic development.
Yeah, what I'm understanding, having talked to some of the current council members in terms of the current budgetary situation with the village, is that within another year, the village is going to be in the black. To me, the biggest, as I've said before, the biggest institution that is going to draw more jobs and more business here is Antioch College. And the fact that the college is back is key. I think that you know, the people that saw the essential nature of that institution to our community were absolutely right. We can find it, we can kind of feel the energy from the fact that the college is coming back. But a lot of the small businesses that are coming back, and I agree with Mary Ann, some of, you know, we have to be careful that our own rules are not standing in the way of small business development in the village.
If I understood the question correctly, it was the 50.
Could you hand that to Jared? It's a long question.
Okay, we're looking at medium sized businesses, you know, 50 to 100. And I have to say that it's now up to the community. There was a plan afoot that was soundly defeated, and I think it was just about 2 years ago. But no one has really come forward with Plan B. Okay, and to attract the business, you gotta have the infrastructure at least up to a park or long end, so that the business can go from there. The way I see it now is that from a council person standpoint, is to go out and see if I can find some investors that are willing to come in and help us with that burden of providing the infrastructure. Unfortunately, we lost what I thought was a good young man as our assistant village manager. He had some ideals and so forth, and I felt that given time, we may be able to go forward. The problem I see now is we may be too late in terms of attracting those larger businesses. So we have to find a place for our smaller businesses that we have here that may grow and stay here in Yellow Springs, and that's going to be key. But again, some of our successful small businesses are growing faster than we're going to be able to provide the facilities and the infrastructure that they need. So I say it's back at the community.
Thank you, Jerry. We started out with a humdinger of a question there.
I think one of the main things council can do, and they're working on it, is assessing all the available lands that we do have available, space where businesses can go. And also, Jerry touched on this, I thought John Young's economic development plan was brilliant, and I really regret that we lost him so soon. I would hope that the village manager and council would really work together on that document and put a lot of that into action, and it will help.
Thank you, Chrissy. The next question kind of piggybacks on Lee's question to the Miami Township candidates, and it is proposed the village annex a portion of Glen Helen. What do each of you see as the financial impact to the village?
As a present council member, we did hear a presentation from the Glen Helen group for the village to annex the Glen. And the question I asked at the council meeting at the time the presentation was made is, you know, what's in it for me? Okay. And yes, I get a lot more land, beautiful land that is preserved, but it's going to cost me something. I already know that I have some officers that will not be able to walk through Glen. Okay? But I also know that why the Glen wants us to take it over is for police protection. And, you know, right now we have a 12-member force. The Glen is very big. We take one of our officers that is on duty, and he has to go out into the Glen, and that leaves me with one person protecting the rest of the community. You know, I get a little bit nervous about that. Okay. The other part of it is that right now, I don't know, but if I have to provide sewer, water, electric, other utilities out to the Glen, can I do it?
My sense is that annexing the portion of the Glen that has been recommended would not significantly impact the village financially. At the same time, I never want to make a decision when I don't feel like I both have gotten as much information as I can and also heard from the citizens. And I have heard from a couple citizens who have concerns about this. So I'm not prepared to make a decision, and I imagine that this will be an ongoing conversation between the Glen and the village for a while.
I just think that for the village to make this decision, it needs to understand the real, you know, really the impact. And the probable greatest impact is going to be on our police department. And so I think more information is essential to make a good decision here.
I've still been going back and forth on this one because I have spoken to a couple of police officers who they would not feel very comfortable running around in the Glen, especially in, at night, in the dark. They said they wear 30 pounds worth of gear and heavy vests. And, for various reasons, they wouldn't be comfortable. So that's a concern to me. Fiscally, I can't imagine that it wouldn't cost us some expense. But on the other hand, the Glen is a very valuable resource to our community. And supposedly, the police officers would mostly just be a handing over from the ranger or whoever's working with Glenn that day. It would be something, they're not really going to be running around with it a lot. So I haven't made a decision on this yet, but I have been paying attention to it. I think it's a very important decision that the community hasn't had enough conversation about yet.
Thank you. Who should pay for sidewalk repairs, the village or property owners?
I think this should be split between the two, personally. And when the village took over responsibility for the sidewalks, since then, very few sidewalks have been repaired. The money is not there to do it, is the reason. I really don't know about who should have the responsibility, but if we're going to hand it back to the homeowners, and I recommend this at council, I don't see why there can't be some sort of system put into place where the village pays part and the homeowner pays part so that the costs are lowered for both sides. I mean, the village was accepting being responsible for the sidewalks completely, so they're going to win because they're not going to be completely responsible. The homeowners used to be responsible completely, so they're going to win. They won't be completely responsible. But that's just what I thought about so far.
Little mic etiquette. It loves it when it's close to your mouth.
I was on the council when we changed the policy making the village responsible for sidewalks. My view is that it's an issue of fairness. Sidewalks are public good, and the public as a whole should take responsibility for it. Not all homeowners have sidewalks. There's whole neighborhoods that do not have sidewalks. There's neighborhoods where one side of the street has sidewalks. I don't understand how that's how it in terms of fairness and who gave the public good of good sidewalks. To me, it's a general good. It's not just a good for the person living in that house. So it's just an issue of fairness in my mind.
I think it makes sense for the village to take responsibility for the sidewalks because, as Judith said, it's public transportation, and to the degree that we want to have a walkable, bikeable community, I think it makes sense to take that on as the community. That said, we have to have a plan that works. It doesn't just look good on paper. The idea, when we turn it back to the citizens, then we would have to enforce the citizens doing it, which is not easy to do. If we split it between the citizens and the village, that I think would be even more difficult in terms of having a system that works. But as you probably know, having the village take responsibility hasn't been real successful so far either. So I really do think that as a community, we have to say, how important is it? If it's really important to the community to have excellent sidewalks throughout the community, then I assume people would vote for that in a sidewalk levy. If it isn't that important to the majority of the community, then I think we would go back to what the village is doing of repairing every year 50,000 or whatever we set aside and taking the sort of key sidewalks that need to be repaired.
I'm at a dilemma here. I got a sidewalk in front of my property, but no sidewalks on the back. So, the side. So, if I'm speaking from the side, I'll let the village take care of it. If I'm speaking from the front, whether the village takes care of it or I take care of it, I'm still going to pay. Because I'm going to pay the taxes or the levy for whatever it may be for the village to do it, or I'm going to get a second mortgage or whatever for me to do it. Okay. The bottom line is the community has to tell us just how important sidewalks are. And if the village decides and the residents decide they're important and they want them fixed, then we all pay for it, because we're all going to use some portion of those sidewalks.
Thank you. The next question kind of talks about who pays. What are your ideas on controlling or cutting back services costs to contain taxes at the current level? Chris says, no new taxes.
Now, if you want to start,
you're off.
No new taxes. We run our own utilities, you know, electric, water, sewer, and waste. Okay? So, if we say, you know, we have to provide electricity, we have to provide water, okay? We don't have to collect the solid waste, but we also have to take care of the sewers, okay? So what does that say? We're going to have to raise the rates so that we're able to maintain the system and also buy and pay for our new water plant. You know, it's, as a present council member, I can't run from that issue. That's just the fact of life. Okay? Yellow Springs is not a cheap place to live in. We demand the best of the services, so we're going to have to pay for them. It's as simple as that. Or we board up the buildings and go someplace else. Yeah, you got to pay to stay.
What are your ideas on controlling or cutting back services, the cost to contain taxes at the current level? No new taxes.
Okay. In terms of the projections that were given to council on Monday, we should not need new taxes, and we should be able to maintain the current level of services. And this is not considering our utilities, which are separate, and as I said, whatever our utilities cost the village have to be recouped from the consumers, the residents and the businesses. If we were going to be cutting services and cutting taxes, and I'm not recommending that we do that, I suppose I'd first look at the police department, because that is the biggest budget item, cut some of the police. If we needed to do more cuts, we could also sell the parks, close them down. We could close down a lot of the Bryant Center, probably. I am not suggesting that we do this, but if for example, we didn't renew the tax levy, which will be on the ballot next year, and we have about $700,000 less, then we would have to look for how we would cut $700,000 in the budget.
Yeah, I mean, I agree that there should be no increase in the levy. It sounds to me like currently we're having an increase in revenues. The village is having an increase in revenues, and I'm assuming it's because of the businesses in the village and the college. Increased taxation is coming into the village coffers, so for the moment, it doesn't look like that's an issue. But if there was an issue, I think we'd have to prioritize the services that we have. And now we're not talking about utilities, that's not about taxes. And, you know, seeing where we can make cuts, and I think there are places that we can make some cuts. Not everybody would be happy with it, I'm sure, but we would just have to look at all the things that we provide for, and we're going to have to find a way to reduce costs. And in the past, before the levy, the streets were not kept up as well. That was one place where they were keeping costs down. I'm not saying we should do that, but that is but that might be a place where we could find ways to cut back on costs. The police department is over 50% of our budget, general fund budget. Finding ways to reduce that, I think, is a place. If we get out of the ACE task force, we actually will be reducing that budget.
You'll have to turn yours off.
All right, well.
There we go. I think that there were already some cuts made to the budget last year because there were concerns in this area. A lot of departments, I know our HRC budget was cut slightly. And that's one of the things that I'm really interested in learning about by being on Village Council and working on. I would like to see where there are places where we can cut expenses so that we don't have to give up some of the amenities that we really enjoy, which are part of the reason why people live in Yellow Springs. A few years back, they were talking about having to close the swimming pool, and the swimming pool is something that so many people enjoy. And I can't imagine that there aren't ways that we can find to cut budgets more. I know that by hiring the finance director as our new assistant village manager, they pointed out that this is going to save us a substantial amount of money every year. And so I'm sure that there are lots of other ways. Not having been on council yet, I don't know, but that's one of the things I really want to delve into. The numbers, I don't completely understand the budgets. I go over them, and I honestly haven't been sitting through a lot of the budget meetings because I felt like when I get on council, I would have to do that, and right now I don't have to. I do go through, so why put myself through it? It's not that much fun. I do go through the budget reports on the parts that interest me and aspects, and like I said, we cut back a lot. HRC, our budget got cut by $1,500 this year. I think almost every other department in the village offices, they took cuts to their budget. So there are ways of doing that. I don't know all about them, but I can't wait to find out.
Well, as I told you in the beginning, I am responsible for getting us out of here on time. But the man with the real authority told me that this has to be the last question. Mm-hmm. And that question is for everyone. And this is the question. Many villagers feel that since the shift within the police department from many officers who live in Yellow Springs and are our neighbors to the current situation, whereas only one full-time officer is, I'm assuming they're saying, a resident of Yellow Springs, who is a part of our community, that our officers have become overly aggressive in enforcing the letter of the law rather than the spirit. As village council, what would you do to address this, if you feel that that's the case?
I think a big part of the problem is that, as the chief has admitted himself, we haven't had a clear set of policies for our police department. For instance, with mayor's court, that the police officers can choose. Do I want to take this to mayor's court, or do I want to take this through Xenia? And I've talked to quite a number of the police officers myself, and I've thought about this question a lot, whether or not we should want our officers to live in town. I really don't think it's completely necessary. I think if they, for instance, with the police chief, at first I thought, well, he should live in our town. Later I've thought that over, and especially since I've seen Chief Hale and his wife here in town attending many events, and there are other ways to be part of the community besides just living here. And so I really don't see that as a big question, having them live here in the town. And now I lost the thread of the second part of that question.
I think you answered it.
Oh, okay. And I don't think they've gotten overly aggressive simply because they don't live here. I think that's either your nature or it's not. I don't think that really comes into the equation.
Well, Well, we can't require police officers to live in our community. It's against the law to require that. It used to be possible to do that. Communities could do that. You no longer can do that. But I think, I do feel, you know, given the national conversation around policing that's evolved in the last year, which has, you know, spawned the Black Lives Matter movement and the closer look at police practices, the militarization of the police, and we're a small community, but we're not untouched by that, by the kind of, you know, kind of training, kind of the standards of training, etc. We're part of the drug task force, so. So I feel like the it's important that we're really in a position now to have a community conversation about policing, police policy, with citizens and with our police department and with our elected people. And I believe that it's important. Obviously, Village Council is not going to set every policy for the police department. There are lots of policies a police department has. But I think looking over those policies and having a public discussion about them and seeing the places where we would like to see changes so that police officers can feel more connected to the community can feel more connected to the police officers. I think that that happens partly through this kind of a conversation and thinking about the kind of training. I think there's a real opportunity because of this national debate that has evolved in the last many months.
I think in the past, until the last couple of years, councils had a sort of hands-off policy in regard to policing. And that is changing, and it's changing partly because I think of what Judith said. So over the last couple of years, we've had two community forums about what the citizens want from the police. We had a community forum where the new chief was came and talked. Council itself had a forum with the community to talk about what direction council wants the police to take. And in 2016, we will be continuing conversations, for example, about the mayor's court. So I think that this is going to be an ongoing conversation. In terms of officers being overly aggressive, sometimes that's interpretation. And interpretation means that there then has to be some kind of communication. So the chief of police says he has an open door policy. He wants to hear what people have to say. I encourage people, if they go to the chief and don't feel that they're getting heard the way they want to, that they go to our village manager, and if that doesn't help, that they come to council members, come to us. I think all of us are open to engaging in this. One thing that I am wanting to look at is the idea of having mediation between police and citizens when there's been some kind of issue. Dayton has started doing this. And I have started the conversation with our mediation program, and we'll be talking to council and our police department about instituting this kind of program as one means to have communication between the police and the citizens, because I think that's really what it's about, being able to hear what each side is saying and be able to be heard.
Being on the inside and on council, it's a little different than being on the outside looking. We get a lot more information, either individually or as a group, as to what goes on in the police department. Since I've been on council, I think the chiefs have done a very good job in weeding out the good officers from the bad officers. Over-aggressiveness and so forth. Right now, it's hard to determine. But I think even though we have a small department, that all of our officers should have cameras, okay, to be able to document exactly what has happened. I guess I've been more fortunate than a lot of the community to be able to see some of the video from the cameras that are on the our police cars. And you kind of wonder sometimes what I saw versus what I heard and what was written. My eyes must be awful bad. I think our police officers do a very good job. I came here early when housing was really affordable, and a lot of our officers moved here and they lived. We're in an age now where everybody has mobility, they have choice. Okay? The key is to make sure we're hiring right to begin with. You know, and if not, get rid of them.
Thank you. Each of you answered the question so thoughtfully, and we really do appreciate that. We will be here a little bit later if you want to come up and ask some personal questions or some questions that we did not get to today in the forum. I'd like us to give a hand to our candidates. In closing out this evening's forum, I'd like to invite to the stage the Village Charter Commission members, Brian Hausch and Sheila Miller. There were a few questions in regards to some changes that have been made, and they were asked to speak here this evening for anyone who is interested.
Make it a little more intimate.
So, where'd Sheila go?
Oh, hey. Snuck up on me. So I was asked to make two clarifying comments, and then I'm going to turn it over to Sheila, who was the chair of the Charter Review Committee. The first being that what triggered the Charter Review was simply the confusion that came about from the referendum that happened related to the CBE. And with regards to that, what we realized is Yellow Springs has a process, state has a process, according to the Ohio Revised Code. To make the referendum happen, you had to follow both of those processes. We cannot get around with our charter state law. So the changes that were made to referendum, initiative, and recall were to simplify, direct everyone to the Ohio Revised Code. You can find it online, it's very straightforward. So now there's just one process instead of two. It makes it simpler for citizens that want to initiate any of those factors. Second thing was related to the Office of the Mayor. And again, the committee made no recommendations to make any changes there. But what we did realize through careful review was that there was a policy decision to be made. And that was referenced by Marianne earlier. And it is on our timetable. We're dealing with ACE Task Force this year. With a new council coming on, the next step will be to look at how we can maximize the effectiveness of Mayor's Court. And the chief himself has asked council for direction on discretion or no discretion with citing things to various courts. So it has nothing to do with the charter, but it is definitely something that we will be addressing soon. So what you have, and I brought the educational material, they're in the back if you haven't seen that, is basically correcting 100 plus grammatical errors, clarifying things that were confusing, and conforming to Ohio law. And as it was stated, we have no choice, all right? We do have some leeway with the charter on things that are not in Ohio Revised Code, but basically, if it's in the Revised Code, we've got to follow it. And so it makes sense for our charter to be up to date. So I'm going to hand it over to Sheila.
Okay, so I also have some other charter committee members. And we are the charter committee, not the commission, because the charter commission gets elected. So we were asked to do this to give this to council. Council gets to decide then. And they took some things, and most of the stuff, but didn't take everything that we had on the original piece that we sent them. But we have Laura Curlis, who is on the committee, and Craig Major, who's on the committee. And Jerry, yes, I'm sorry, Jerry also is on the committee. And then we had other members, too. There were six citizens, a couple council members, Brian and Jerry. We also, probably most importantly, had the village manager and the village clerk sit in. That's where the changes that were proposed came from, was they'd say, you know what? It says here that we're going to swear people in November, but that election doesn't get certified sometimes until then. So it was those kinds of questions that we were dealing with, is the kinds of questions where we need to make sure that the charter is, again, congruent with the Ohio Revised Code, but also these little problems that might arise, like the initiative was confusing, let's do something about it. Most of the changes are clarity, and is the charter perfect now? No, we rejected things just because you see how intimidating that long thing that you got in the mail is. You've got to read through it sometimes just to find out that we had to make a plural on that change or things like that. So it's not perfect. We'll keep doing this. I was on the committee that did this 7 years ago. Jerry's here. He was on that committee as well. And we'll probably keep doing it because there's still things in that charter that we probably would like to change, but we didn't get to it. I think that probably one of the more major changes in terms of a policy piece is also the same thing that we put before council in 2007 when I was on that committee, and it's about having the Planning Commission at that time. The charter says there must be somebody from Miami Township that's not a resident of the village on the Planning Commission, and at that time we were trying to remove that from the charter. The village said, and the council, you know, they're the elected officials, they get to decide. Well, no, we don't really want to do that. This time it came back again, and they said, you know what, we're having a hard time sometimes finding that person who wants to sit on the Planning Commission that lives outside the village. And what we did was change it to there may be somebody instead of there has to be somebody, but you still can have that. And I think, again, some of the what Brian talked about was looking at those changes to make sure that people would just go to the Ohio Revised Code and see how do you do a petition for a referendum and a recall. I think it's a better charter with the changes. I hope you vote for them. But again, it's not a perfect charter. We'll probably still, there might be things we still work on in the future.
Thank you. I don't want it said that I'm not intimate, so I came down here to say goodnight. Please, there are there's literature on the back tables. Of course, the candidates are here to speak to. Most importantly, we thank each of you for attending and being interested in your village. So if I may ask, please give yourself an applause.
And I'd like to thank you as well. I want to thank Jalen for, again, doing a good job.